And we don't have time for charlatans, and we don't have time for flim-flam.
The following has been rated PC for politically correct.
Pay attention, you just may learn something.
It's the Sage, Larry Elder.
I often talk to you about double standards. We're going to get into more fallout, by the way, from the Bannon book. Bannon, by the way, has now been kicked out of Breitbart. I told you that the board was considering doing that, and the apparently the largest donor to Breitbart had pulled her support from him. Bannon had back-to-back gaffes. The first one, of course, was Roy Moore, but he also backed, at least briefly, a candidate against Paul Ryan, to primary Paul Ryan on the Republican side, and it turns out to be a candidate who had some sort of associations with white nationalists. His name appeared and picture appeared on website, white nationalist website, so Bannon dropped him like a cheap suit, but the damage had been done. This is back-to-back gaffes. And now, apparently, it turns out, according to CNN, that Steve Bannon was involved in an anti-Trump document, not the famous dossier, but another anti-Trump document in 2015 when he's working for a group that did not want Trump to win, a group that supported Ted Cruz. We'll be talking about that later on as well. But first, President Trump has gotten a great deal of criticism for, quote, not understanding the relationship between the president and the attorney general, between the president and the Department of Justice, between the president and the FBI. The president and the FBI are supposed to be independent from each other, arm's length. We hear over and over and over again, and the president is committing obstruction of justice by going up to Jeff Sessions and saying things like, can't you just let this thing go, by going to Comey saying, yeah, can't you just, you have to do this. The president is violating his principles of the office, blah, 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 blah. You hear that over and over and over again, don't you? The president can't tell Jeff Sessions what to do. He just can't fire Bob Mueller. He just can't. Over and isn't that the mantra? Now, one of the things I find fascinating since the election of Obama is that a lot of people apparently never paid attention to politics until Obama became president. And therefore, they have no frame of reference. And therefore, they make a lot of stupid statements, such as nothing like this has ever happened before to a president, yada blah, etc. Oh, yeah, it has, many times. You just don't know anything. It's called history. Learn some of it. For example, this business about President Trump colluding with the Russians. I'm still trying to figure out what exactly he's supposed to have done. I'm looking at it from the prism of Maxine Waters. I'm trying to anyway, and it's difficult, but I'm trying. I even put on a wig once. And I said, now how would Maxine Waters view this? What's the worst thing that President Trump or President-elect Trump or candidate Trump did? What did he do? What did he do? His son took a meeting with a person who claimed to have some information on Donald Trump, who was a Russian national. And the meeting apparently ended with the person not having any information, and there's some confusion over whether or not the son informed President Trump, now President Trump, of this meeting. That's it? That's what this investigation is about? And Trump may have some holdings here and some investments here. He's a businessman! He's a real estate developer. He's got businesses all over the world. He's a billionaire. And if there's any finagling going on, anything illegal, that happened before he became president. What's that have to do with his job now? That's it? Let's talk about collusion. 1984, Reagan running for re-election. Guess who used his best friend John Tunney, a senator, to convey a message to the head of the Soviet Union that, hey, you guys support me, and I'll tell you how to handle improving your image over here. That person was Ted Kennedy, who briefly ran for president in 84. Is this thing on? Any investigation for collusion? But the president is profane. The president curses. The president is... Ann Compton worked for years at ABC News. She retires. And then she says, didn't say it when she was working, wonder why. On two occasions, President Obama was so angry at the media, off the record, he blasted us, dropping F-bombs, dropping all sorts of profanity. But I thought Obama was courtly.
and graceful and smooth and never raised his voice and wasn't bombastic like Obama, like Trump is. Collusion.
Obama in 2008 during the campaign goes to Iraq when Iraq is talking with George W. Bush about whether to leave a stay behind force, how big the stay behind force is. And according to the Iraqis, Obama said, hey, just hold off on the negotiations. Wait till I become president and they'll go much better. The Obama camp denies having said it. Was there an investigation on collusion? Collusion during a war? Is this thing on? I don't think this thing is on, Mr. McConnell. Can you check and see if this thing is on? I don't believe this thing is on. I think for the last 15 minutes I've been speaking into a blank mic. Make more sense that way, don't I? 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. Guess who Trump said in 1999 would be his first VP choice if he decided to run for president? Guess who? Guess who? Guess who? I'm Larry Elder. Don't leave town. Now, President Trump, back in 1999, was on the Larry King show. And by the way, I'm going to be interviewed tomorrow by Larry King on his show on RTV, I think it's called. It's also online. And he was asked by Mr. King who would be his first choice as running mate. And here is what then-citizen Trump said.
Do you have a vice presidential candidate in mind?
Well, I really haven't gotten quite there yet.
Oprah.
I love Oprah. Oprah would always be my first choice.
Oprah.
Oprah, your competitor, right?
Oprah's competitor.
You know what?
No
she's. I'll tell you, she's really a great woman, though. She is a terrific woman. She's somebody that's very special. I have not even thought about it. I guess we'll see. We'll see. Maybe that's part of the whole process.
Would she be some? I mean, kidding aside, that you might think about.
If she'd do it, she'd be fantastic. I mean, she's popular. She's brilliant. She's a wonderful woman. I mean, if she'd ever do it, I don't know that she'd ever do it. She's got.
You'd ask her.
She'd be sort of like me. I mean, I have a lot of things going. She's got a lot of things going.
What a ticket that would be.
That would be a pretty good ticket. But she's a very exceptional woman.
What makes?
Now, forgotten man, help me out here. That was 1999, and Oprah in 1999, as in 2018. Was black. Now Trump in 2018 is a racist. And in 1999, when asked if you run for president, who would be your running mate, he suggested Oprah, who is black. Now I'm thinking, now this is just me, out the box here, you know me. If you're a racist, a white racist, you probably wouldn't want a black person, let alone a woman, as your running mate. I'm thinking. Now, David Duke's run 5 times. And each time, to my knowledge, he never had a black running mate. Be kind of inconsistent with who David Duke is. But Trump, being a bigot, you'd think it would be inconsistent for this bigot to select a black person as a running mate back in 1999, when the country presumably was more racist then than it is now.
Professor John Eastman, former dean of Chapman University College of Law, now joins us. And I was talking about this before you came on, about the double standards. For example, Obama promised to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, as Republican presidents had promised to do that before. Trump does it and the left goes crazy. Obama was upset because NATO wasn't paying enough. Trump makes the same complaint. NATO does step up, but now Trump is called a bully who wants to destroy NATO. Obama, Harry Reid, Clinton, all talked about the problem of illegal immigration, using words that Trump uses today. And now, of course, Trump is a racist for saying the same thing. And Trump has been hammered for his failure, in quotes, to understand the relationship between president and the AG. And I'm holding in my hands, John Eastman, an article from Politico, headline, Eric Holder, I'm still the president's wingman. He's on a radio show called The Tom Joyner Show, and he's asked A.G. Holder is if he's still going to stay with the Obama administration. And, Professor, here's his answer. Quote, I'm still enjoying what I'm doing. There's still work to be done. I'm still the president's wingman, so I'm here with my boy, so we'll see, close quote. Can you imagine what would happen if Jeff Sessions said something like that?
Oh, I know. I know. It's the double standard is really stunning. The fact of the matter is, the Attorney General is not an office set up by the Constitution. The executive branch has an office, and it's the President of the United States. All executive power flows through him and is accountable to him. That's the only way us voters, the sovereign people of this country, have any say in the conduct of the executive branch. So the Attorney General works for the President. He's not an independent agency, an independent, you know, we don't have a special prosecutor over there. The functions of the Department of Justice are derivative of the functions of the Office of the President.
Professor John Eastman is my guest. Professor, I even heard a Democratic member of Congress yesterday on either CNN or MSNBC complain about his feeling that the president's been interfering. And he says that we have separate branches of government. There's the president and there's the Department of Justice. Separate branches of government? And even the host politely corrected him and informed him this was the same branch of government known as the executive branch.
Yeah, no, and this is a member, of Congress.
Yeah.
The level of ignorance by our elected officials is just stunning.